to Download and Delete. I am your co-host, Ty Monthier.
And I'm your other co-host, Shauna Lucas.
And we're cool as fuck today because we're wearing our cool fucking sunglasses at night. Yeah.
They can't see us, but we're like, we decided.
If you're tuning in on YouTube, you can definitely see us.
Don't tell people to log in on YouTube to see us. I might have a bonnet on one day.
Log in so you can see Shauna and her bonnet, y'all. Welcome to Download and Delete.
Yeah.
Where we're going to get right off into our motivation moment.
Yeah, let's go ahead and get it going.
What is motivating me today is just resilience and just getting past things in life, you know, just to keep going. Sometimes we be like confused, like, I don't know how to feel today. Just do something. Just be resilient and say, no matter what happened yesterday, today will be a better day.
Oh, I love that.
Thank you.
Is that the mantra? No matter what happened yesterday, today
will be a better day. Yes.
Is that kind of like being present?
Yes, being here.
Or being futuristic.
Here and now.
Okay, so is that present or is that futuristic?
Well, you have to be here now to even make it to the future, so I think it's being both.
Did you just sing Luther Vandross?
Unfortunately, I did. Some people may have liked Luther Vandross, but yeah.
I like Luther.
I like the person, not the music so much. Kind of made us feel old, you know?
Yeah, that was velvet voice, platinum.
I'll pass on the velvet.
Well, I was trying to think about, you know, what I'm motivated by. So many things, you know, especially because the weather in Wisconsin has been just
wonderful.
Out of the ordinary. Very warm. I've been like enjoying the nice air and sunshine and getting some vitamin D and walking.
It's been fresh.
Yeah, it's been really exciting. Nice. You know, and I work really, I'm so blessed to work so close to our natural resource that is Lake Michigan. And
do you smell it?
It doesn't. I'm telling you, I don't know what's going on. I don't know if it was, you know, us humans being locked in for so long that we couldn't dump our shit in the lake, but it just seems clear and fresh. And I mean, when I went down there,
it's all those stellar chemicals they've been plotting and putting in there.
Oh, wow. I went down there and no room. I remember the days where you couldn't really get in the lake, like there were dead fish floating and it smelled.
Really?
Yeah, hell yeah. You don't remember?
No,
I got
pictures when my mother and father used to always go down to Lake Michigan and like us being there and the water was so pretty. I'm like, where did this come from? It's not like that now.
Yeah, and I remember years where it was very murky. It had a smell. As soon as you got out of the car, you can sometimes smell it while you were driving past it. But I'm telling you, it is something's going on. There's like a revitalization or something happening with that lake. There were actually people in there swimming. Just like they jumped in the lake like it was.
Well, you notice the bear people do that every year. The polar bear people.
No, this was like regular old, you know, young guys jumping in the lake, being baptized in the waters of Lake Minnetonka.
Baptized in the funk.
No, remember that line from Purple Rain?
What?
When he made her get into the water naked.
No.
Come on now. You don't remember that? Mm-hmm. Okay, anyway, you look that up. You're going to remember it for next time.
I want to look it up. You know, so I like some Purple Rain.
I like some Prince. But anyway, I didn't want to talk about all of the natural beauty that has inspired me, even though that's worth mentioning. But you and I were talking about something I did today. There was a pop-up in Milwaukee for a clothing shop called Unfinished Legacy. And I feel like not enough people know about this because I didn't know about it. I just happened to know about it because the founder of this this pop-up or this clothing line, whose name is Brema, he's like a young, I think he's like 19 or 20, and he's got a very successful clothing line. And so yes, and so I went in there, and let me tell you, I'm gonna keep it real. I went in there with my auntie lens on, like being an old ass, like this is for the young folk, you know, like really doing that, you know, really, like, because it's graphics, it's you know, colors and a lot of you know, images on cloth and yes, you know, like ink on his jeans and
expensive.
Yes, it's like a lot. But, you know, he's hand screen printing this stuff. He's not like outsourcing it. You know, he's doing the graphics. I think he has a background in graphic arts. He's just like a really humble young Black man trying to make it happen. He got a partnership with the Bucks,
which is so dope.
Really dope. If you look at his, you know, Instagram or some other, you know, attention he's gotten for his work, then you will see what he's doing. But it's just like so motivating to see someone so young being successful in Milwaukee, 20, right?
Black in Milwaukee.
Yes.
And he's a Black boy. He's not a Kia boy. He's not selling cars.
Right.
He's not doing all that.
He's not rapping.
Stuff,
he's not trying to be a rap star.
Really lift him up and motivate him. You
know what I'm saying? I love that. Dope. Thank you. I love that. So I'm so happy. It was very motivating.
There is another young lady. She started her clothing brand. Her clothing brand is called Brown Love. And she has really cute clothing. I'm going to show Shauna, and it's brownloveclothing.com. Check her clothing out. It's all her sister does the art. Her sister's like 13, 14. So these young kids are really taking over the fashion market. Like, and she's from Milwaukee, and it's really cute.
Oh, love. Ooh.
Yeah.
That's
and she
so
has,
cute.
Like, you can custom your shirt if it's a man or a woman you want, which art you want. And she has a 20% off sale right now. So make sure you guys,
I love that,
go to brownloveclothing.com and support our Milwaukee people.
I love that. I want to make sure that you, that people know that we absolutely do support fashion,
yes,
leaders in, yes, Milwaukee. We've had them on the show before, so
definitely,
you know, we are definitely
Ratchet
motivated
luxury
by that.
Ratchet
Luxury, that's right. Yes. And there are lots more, so maybe we need to try to find more and feature them,
yes,
on the show when we get a chance.
Yes, that would be dope.
My daughter may not be here. I'll call you back, honey. Okay.
All right, so we're going to get right into our show, and it's time to download. You ready, Shauna?
Yeah.
So what's going on, Shauna? What you need to download and get off your mind today? Tell us what's going on.
I almost want you to go to see what direction you're going to take this.
Okay, I'll go.
Okay.
So me and my friend were speaking on the phone. We brought this topic up today, public school versus private school, you know, collegiate school, prep schools, you know, are they better or worse than public schools? And do you get a different education? And we were talking and he was like, so-and-so needed additional, English as a second language class. What's it called?
ESL.
ESL. I was like, what?
Yeah.
He was like, y'all didn't have ESL? I was like, no. He was like, y'all didn't have any foreign kids or anybody at your school? I was like, no.
Yeah.
It was Black, white, Asian, Puerto Rican. They were foreign, but everybody spoke English. We just had English. We didn't have any of these different classes. So we were just saying, like, it was a whole bunch of stuff that I missed or probably I didn't have to go through. And like how public schools had to, like, have to teach you stuff. Like, they would have a sentence on the board every day and they have to correct it every day. And I'm like, what?
Yeah, that's I know in the district I work in, it's called ML, multilingual.
I never have done these things. We just had an English teacher teach us English, and you do that work and you do it or you fail. But a lot of students who went to, and what sparked the conversation was, so that's why a lot of kids who transferred from my school went to high school and they were skipped a grade. So, I mean, is private school better? Because my mother was a Milwaukee public school teacher. So it's like, she kept me out of Milwaukee public schools for a reason, but she taught.
Wait, there. So the ESL, right? English language, ELL?
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it's called ESL, ML, ELL, whatever. So you're saying that it was in public school but not in private?
We didn't have it at my school.
Yeah, interesting.
I went to a Catholic private school.
Yeah.
And I didn't have it in middle school. I went to private school all my life that I can remember. Mm. I don't remember anything public.
Well, I mean, that kind of goes to show you the differences between what public schools and private schools must offer in their philosophy for educating the masses. You know, they have to, the public schools have to have a philosophy of, you know, how do we better society for all? And public schools are like, we don't have to do that for everybody.
Wow.
You know, we can do it for
just the people who may pass,
or the people who are Catholic or who are Protestant or Presbyterian. Or
I feel like I missed out on the like high school cliques, maybe the, I don't know. I think maybe I didn't. I think we had the same thing, but it was in a different capacity at the private school. I don't know. I think I kind of missed out on like the camaraderie of in public school. I don't know.
The community?
I guess, but I think I had that in private school. I'm still friends with some of my friends from high school now.
Okay, so do you think that the restrictions that Catholic schools have contribute to the experience of students?
Restrictions like uniforms, maybe
those, and like
we had those in middle school
who
can afford
access, yeah, right, to private schools.
I think so, because we had choice kids there too. We had some people that were on scholarship there too, so they weren't so they were trying to live up to those standards, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I was in a mindset that now I look back and say, thank you, Mom, because I don't know if I could have made it in public school, because I know my attitude is not good. And then I probably would have tried, they probably would have tried to bully me. It was like, he gay. And then it would have been like torture for them, because I would have like killed them.
Yeah, not you really, know what? But I mean, let me see if I can even remember how people who were different were treated. I mean, I think
I didn't have to go through any bad.
Yeah, I think they like had that. To do a lot to fit in, for sure. Right.
I didn't.
Or you find your tribe, you know, like,
yeah, I'm thankful for that.
Yeah, it's interesting. And just imagine, like, I was in a public school and I was like, you know, we've talked about this extensively, but, you know, I went at a time where people were mostly segregated in the Midwest. So like, if you were Black, you went to the schools in this area. If you were white, you went to schools in all the other areas.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we lived in an area for a while where I was able to go to school with mostly white students. And so just imagine what that must have been like to try to have to fit in, you know?
That's awful. I don't know what I would have done. I don't know if I could have been me, because I don't think I was my full self in high school. I don't think anybody was their full self in high school, but I don't think I could have been me in high school.
Oh, it's definitely,
I wish I could have been me in high school.
Right. Oh, I mean, it's absolutely a performance. It absolutely is completely exhausting to keep it up.
To being somebody you totally are not.
That's
or
right.
Just trying to keep your life a secret.
That's right.
Oh my God, I'm so thankful that is over.
Right.
So people don't understand like the stress of being 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 even. Like those kids, and I like to mess and tease and say I'm scared of kids that age, but I really am, because at that time you're just so emotionally wired that anything can trigger a behavior, and you just like, did you just bust out all the car windows because you was mad? You didn't know how to process that? You know what I'm saying? It's like, wow. So I'm thankful that I had a lot of guidance at that time, and I was able to process my emotions in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, when you take time and reflect and look over your life and think things over, you can just be appreciative of where you're at. Not saying that private school is better than public school, but I thank God for my experience, because I probably wouldn't have done public school good.
Yeah.
People like they public school ghetto, but private school is ghetto too. We had fights, cuts, everything, drugs, everything.
I was thinking about asking you that too, you know, like if you feel like there were like some parallels between what people talk about as the public school experience, you know, why people are even afraid to go to public schools because of the lack of resources, the bad school lunches, the fights, the cliques, the bullying, you know, the teachers who don't care, or whatever people think about, you know,
teachers in private school don't have to be college educated.
Well, and they are, I think they usually make, they typically make less than public school teachers.
So they don't have to be educated. Well, I could probably make, they probably make some around the same amount. Some probably pay more.
Well, you know, because public school teachers have labor unions and they negotiate their wages and all that kind of stuff.
I was I was a private school kid on public school benefits, and the public school benefits back in the day was not a game for teachers, okay?
I think that's fascinating. Let me just bring up this point. Yes. I think it's fascinating how I've seen a lot of teachers, particularly people who are like in an administrative role who have children, send their kids to private schools.
That's what my mom did.
Or suburban schools. Mm-hmm. What's up with that?
I think because she said, I work in this environment and I don't want my child to have to go through this. And I know my mom knew I was gay. So I think that she knew that she didn't want to have to always defend me at school or have to have be coming to my back. I think she wanted to do her job successfully because she was an amazing teacher. Like her funeral was packed with students, like standing outside. That's how packed it was. So I think she kind of wanted to split it up, and she knew she was there to make her money and to make a difference, but she knew she couldn't fight with me. Mm. It was no fight.
Interesting.
Did you send your children to public school?
Absolutely.
You did?
Mm. Yeah. I mean, and I think that they had really good schools that they were able to access. So I can see my screen. They had really good schools that they were able to access. Right. Mm-hmm. So I'm fortunate to be able to have that. I had the choice to send them to really good public schools. One of the things that they were just, you know, I mean, they were decent. They were good schools. They were like the ones that people would consider, you know,
suburban schools.
No, they were like in Milwaukee. One of the things that influenced my decision was that I worked in suburban schools and I saw how Black children were treated in suburban schools.
I went to predominantly Black schools.
Yeah,
though.
Right. So I knew that, you know, I've seen how students who are in the target group or I don't want to say minority. I don't know if I like that. I saw how they're treated in certain environments, and I did not want that. I did not want that. But and then I still knew how to negotiate the conditions of my children's education. You know, I was like, you know, had a level of awareness about how to communicate, and I would send emails to my kids' teachers with my district that I worked at the bottom, my name, Shauna Lucas, with, you know, this school district, bitch, don't fuck with
me. So you knew how to navigate the system. Some parents,
right? I know,
aren't as educated.
I know, and that's what I'm saying. But, you know, but also, I know that there are teachers in Milwaukee Public Schools, and teachers are starting to get more cred right now. They're starting to think about, people are starting to like acknowledge teachers. Quinta Brunson was on Saturday Night Live weeks ago.
She shouted out teachers.
Right. So people are starting to say this. You know, I saw
been
a book
for decades.
Well, I don't know. For a minute there, teachers did kind of shitting on for a second, you know.
Right. Teachers need their reparations, and I need my mama's. Give it back.
Right. So, yeah, I think that there is, teachers are getting cred, but I think that should have always been the thing, because there are some phenomenal Black and white, let me just say that, okay? But in particular, in the teacher workforce, there aren't a lot of Black teachers, but they're in Milwaukee Public Schools. Let me tell you something. There are some phenomenal Black teachers in Milwaukee Public Schools that care about these kids.
And they stress the fuck out.
They are. They're stressed out. But if, and I always said,
very serious.
They are. And I always said that if I had a choice, I might not have a choice of like the kind of social conditions my kids were a part of, because I can't control the communities that all students come from. But I tried to keep an open heart and mind at that dinner table when my kids came home and we talked about these issues that they had and what they saw. and my kids brought their friends to our home to have dinner with us and to talk to me or to talk to us and to see how we did things and felt welcome and open and able to feel like I was a person that they could come to. It was just to just be like community. Just this is what it is. It ain't like we're in isolation. That's I think that's where we started to go wrong is when we stopped being a community, when we stopped seeing other people's children as not a part of our own community. When it's like, that's your problem.
I was like, man, fuck them kids.
Okay, I'm going off on a tangent.
No, that's the truth. That's the truth, you know? That's the truth.
I mean, that tangent.
That's kind of the segregation between, you know, public and private school. While private, because we used to get on the city bus and Riverside kids would get on there and be like, yeah, that's the private school, Mesmer kids, you know, saying all that. And, you know, we would have to act bad, like we would be tough like them. But, child, I was just trying to get home. I didn't really care. I was actually trying to go hump, but
oh, here you go with that.
Well, it was a trend.
I love that.
So let's get into our menu.
No,
question.
Wait.
Oh, you need to download. Dang. Did you finish your download?
No, I was just speaking too much on pun yours, right?
I'm sorry.
Okay, so I'll try to keep my succinct.
No, go for it.
Okay, so I'm going in a different. I feel like I talk too much.
It's a podcast. Hi, welcome to Download and Delete. It's a podcast where we speak.
Where we actually talk about stuff. Okay. So I'm going in a different direction, but it's kind of the same. You're going to get how I bring this together. Okay. So we've had a few school shootings in 2023. Apparently 2022 was like the deadliest year for school shootings ever. Right. I were like, I feel like there were 43. I don't remember. I need to check that. But 2022 was like the deadliest. Who knows why that was? Maybe people coming back from the pandemic, and there was just an explosion of gun violence on school grounds, active shootings.
People had time to think about how they were getting fucked with.
Right, because there's a difference between an active shooter and then just like guns on the school grounds, right? Like on a playground, or whatever. Okay, so active shooters. Last year was really deadly. This year, there have just been a couple really high profile ones, but there are some really high profile ones in 2022.
Where was security at all these schools? Who let these people in?
So that's interesting, because did you hear about so this is a little bit of a tangent, but the incident where the 6-year-old kindergarten student shot his teacher?
He brought it was his daddy gun or his mama gun?
It was his mom's gun.
And he put it in his book bag on accident or something like
not
that?
Not accident. Mm-mm, it wasn't no accident. Because he was showing people on the playground. The students tried to tell on him. The teachers tried to tell the administrator that he allegedly had a gun. They allegedly tried to tell her, and no one really did anything about it until he came. He took it out of his pocket. It's so interesting too, because what I read is that the administrator said, "Oh, his pockets are too small for him to have a gun in it."
Child, they thought they was playing.
It's not funny, but this is what she told this teacher who got shot in the shoulder or whatever, and she is suing for like $4 million or something like that.
How can she sue when they gave her warning and she did nothing?
No, the teacher who got shot is suing the district.
Oh,
and she tried to tell them that this little boy had this gun. He had issues, whatever. I don't want to get in. There's a whole story with that. We can talk about that. But that was one of the shootings that happened. I think that happened this year. And then there was another one that happened in Nashville this year. Did you hear about this one?
With the girl?
Okay, so this happened at a private school.
With the transgender girl?
Yes. Okay, It happened at the Covenant School, a Presbyterian parochial elementary school in the Green Hills neighborhood of Nashville, Tennessee. 6 people were killed at random, 3 students, 3 staff members, including the headmaster of the private school.
Wow.
A transgender man.
What the fuck were they doing to her?
Okay, so a transgender man. This is so we don't have enough information. It's still inconclusive as to why this happened. There's no motive. There's no clear motive. It was random. I mean, I wonder if it wasn't random because the headmaster was killed. So I'm curious about what that must have been about, that the headmaster was killed or whatever.
Was this after or before they passed that? Is this in Tennessee, right?
This is in Tennessee. Is this before or
after they passed that drag bill? Or
I'm not sure. So this is, I'm glad that you brought that up because, yes. So when I was looking at this, I feel like this must have been the first school shooting that happened at a private school. I don't know because I couldn't really find any data about if these shootings have happened at private schools versus public schools. Mm-hmm. But the news media really made it clear that you know, this was a private school. Like, that was just like one of the things that they would say when they talked about this case, is that this is a private school. So I wanted to see if there have been any distinctions made between when a school shooting happened at a private school versus a public school. But it looks like it's a very rare instance that these things happen at private schools. It's usually at a public school. It's usually at a public high school. But some of the most notorious cases have happened in elementary schools. Uvalde and Sandy Hook were all elementary schools. And there are numerous cases of elementary schools, but the bulk.
Do you remember anything in middle school that was this deep for anybody?
You mean like to the point where they wanted to shoot
people? I'm thankful that I went to St. Stephen's Martyr. I went to a Catholic middle school. Before then, I went to Harambe. You know, Sister Mary Clarence, Sister Calista, Sister Anita was not playing them games. Like, I used to ride the bus to school when I was in third grade. So it was a different time, a different day and age. Like, I would never thought to bring a gun to school, to shoot up the school, to hurt everybody.
Yeah. So I've worked at middle schools and I've actually had, so as a middle school student, we had a kid who brought a gun to school, but it was like a hunting gun or something like that. Whoa. And he just wanted to show it as like a, look, I got this hunting gun, and he got expelled or whatever. And then we had a incident when I was a teacher where a student posted pictures holding a gun and making threats. And he didn't do it at our school. I don't want to give too much information, whatever, but he got expelled from his school district for doing that. So
I don't think they should get expelled. I think they need some mental health guidance and maybe like a monitor bracelet or something.
Right.
Like, situations need to be more extreme than you leaving the school.
But guns are such a part of our culture. I mean, even the shooter in at the Covenant School was able to obtain those guns, you know, like just a few days before they went and shot the school.
I talked to a police officer this week, and they were telling me that they just pulled two AR-15s off a 15 and a 16-year-old and shot somebody with this. And when I was 15 and 16, I wouldn't even know what a gun was. I was too worried about getting my pullover coat stolen than getting shot.
Remember those Raider jackets?
Remember those Raider jackets that used to get stolen all the time? I was so worried about a pullover jacket getting stolen.
They were shooting people for Jordans back in the day.
They used to steal your shoes. Wasn't mm-hmm. even a size. Shot. Mm-hmm. They run over. They wanted them. So, I mean, I feel so sorry for these kids that have to go to school with this stress. They have to go to public school, private schools. They have to go to school with this stress. Not only am I stressed out because I'm going through the most emotional time of my life and I don't know what to do because I want to tell my parents, but I don't want to get too close to them because I need to separate. But now I have to worry about my peers that are being teased, coming to school and shooting up the school.
Right.
But then y'all don't want us to do homeschool because y'all wanted to be in the classroom.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But.
And then like screening these kids. I mean, even the shooter, the little boy who shot the teacher, or there was another school shooter whose parents bought him the gun that he used to shoot his classmates, not who are being charged. What kind of screening process processes do we have to take this seriously?
It's our right to bear arms. So you don't need a CCW to have a gun in your home. So everybody can have a gun in their home.
Right. And we
don't need a license to buy a gun.
So you're teaching, you're almost giving this message to your children that, well, this is just what we do. Like, guns are just natural. It's not a serious thing. It's not just for danger. It's for, like, you just got it. You can hold it. You can put it in your backpack. You can bring it to school and show it off. You can shoot somebody with it and, you know, deal with the consequences later. I mean,
not to say that this is mandatory or this is a prerequisite, but I think that what's missing in the schools is actual prayer. Because there is no fear of anything in school anymore. When I was in school, because I guess I went to a Catholic school, we prayed. We were taught about heaven and hell and what you would do to go to hell and what you had to do to go to heaven. So I don't think that these kids have that even thought or notion in their mind that if I shoot this person, they're going to die. Or they're going to be hurt, and then I'm going to go away for the rest of my life. They can't see past that.
Interesting.
And in my time, we were taught past that. Like, if you do this, then this is going to happen.
Eternal fire.
Yeah.
You know, I love how you just made that connection because, you know, I, you know, had all these thoughts about this because there was action around this shooting in Tennessee. Did you hear about the Justins, the two Justins that are members of the Tennessee state legislature? Have you heard about these?
No.
Two?
Are they Republicans?
No, they're Democrats. So after this shooting, so we can go back to this transgender person. So that I think that's fascinating in itself. Like, this is the first trans person who was a school shooter, which is fascinating.
In a state that just passed a law
that's
against.
Right. Yeah. That's right. So I think that's fascinating in itself, but that's another conversation. But at the Tennessee State Capitol, after the shooting, thousands of protesters gathered to call for stricter gun control laws. And that's usually what happens after these events, active shooter events. People protest. They want change. They want stricter gun control laws. The next day, to address this incident, the Tennessee State Legislature passed a law that allowed private schools to hire school resource officers from police departments to help prevent shootings. So they must have, you know, budgeted, allocated a certain amount of resources to hire police officers to protect schools as the solution to
teachers, school shootings. Paying for this schooling and our kids are going to be protected unless we're going to stop paying. And they said, what do we need to do? We need to get security on board.
So they did that right away, effective immediately. So there were the two Justins that I mentioned. They held a protest along with this woman, Gloria Johnson, who's a white woman, a white state legislator. And they were in the gallery of the state legislature in Tennessee, shouting, no more silence, no more silence. We have to do better. Gun reform now. Doing their protest thing. They are noted leaders of like the Black Lives Matter movement, protesters, and they demanded increase gun restrictions and stricter gun laws. And so they delayed a hearing. And as a result of this, they were expelled from the Tennessee state legislature.
Wow.
They voted the next day to expel these two black men from the state legislature. What do you think happened to the white woman, Gloria Johnson?
Nothing.
She
ain't nothing happened to Glow.
She missed that expulsion by like one vote. And she kept her position. And there are reasons why she kept it. Like, she had an attorney come in, blah, blah, blah. She had resources and money and power to make sure.
Why she didn't help the black people with those resources?
She tried. She spoke and said, you know, like, we are in a new era. This is how young people show their protests. This is how they express themselves. We need to start listening to people and not restricting how people express concern about their issues. They're trying to represent their constituents. This is how their constituents feel. we need to listen. So she did say that. I'll give her that credit. But she did have the resources to protect her own ass. I'll say that.
Of course she did.
So anyway, so to your point about prayer in school, and like that was the thing that tied this sense of morality to how students behaved in schools, I was thinking about the two Justins who got, who were these activists in the House, in the state, in the House of Representatives of the state of Tennessee. And I thought about their background. So Justin Jones is, he is like a theology student. He is studying religion in college right now. He talked about how before he went to protest, he thought about the story of the three Hebrew men who emerged unscathed after being thrown into a furnace for refusing to bow before the image of a king. And he's inspired by Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King in his letter from Birmingham jail. Justin Pearson, who is a grandchild of Filipino immigrants and Black people. He gave a sermon on resurrection and tied it to political movements because it was like close to Easter weekend. And he talked about death and rebirth. So I'm wondering if religion might become more and more of how we educate ourselves on what we need to do to create movements and change. If you think that it starts in the schools with, you know, what private schools, the themes that private schools teach.
It starts in the home.
Oh.
It starts in the home. You can be taught whatever you want in the home and go to school and fuck up. But you get that grounding in home. You know what your mom or your dad or your parents will not and won't accept or expect from you. So you have that thing in the back of your mind. I don't want them to fuck me up. So let me do this.
Mm. Or I don't want the devil to fuck me up. Do you think people have no fear of anything anymore?
I don't even think they have any fear of anything anymore. People are so, because everything is so instant, we can get instant gratification just by the click of a finger. Can you click a finger?
Click of a button?
Click of a button. The flick of a finger. There you go. So I think that there is no, they have scientists trying to break away into heaven. You know what I'm saying? So there is no limits anymore in regards to what people can expect or accept. So I think kids or people that go there are fearless, and they go through, they want to prove that, yeah, that is right. I was watching something. This a rapper just got killed. And before he got killed, he had made a video Instagram. He was like, your reality is just your perception and all this. And I was like thinking like, that's so true. But was he so caught up in that he didn't understand what was going on in his reality? Like, in reality, you got, what the hell was that?
That's that rosé getting to you. I heard it, but it's probably footsteps.
Felt like some running, child. Didn't it? Baby.
Don't be looking. You better look.
meanwhile, back on the red. Charlie, it's time to get into our dialogues. You ready?
You done got way
We already done dialogue. Shada, what's your questions today?
Oh my God, you are hilarious. Yo, you got some supersonic senses.
Baby, I heard it.
I heard it, but I ain't seen nothing. Don't even try. You know what? Don't be trying to.
Something in the pipes. That's a Sherman Phoenix.
Stop. Okay. Anyway. That's what I thought it was just footsteps.
Oh no, it was footsteps, all right.
Don't even get me started about all the noises
Don't
I heard.
Don't even get me started. That was so funny on SNL.
Yeah, wasn't that funny? Yeah. I don't know why I still think SNL is funny, but it is. Okay, anyway.
It's the funniest show.
Okay. So my regular question is, so I've seen these job postings at, you know, big private schools in Milwaukee, and they're really innovative jobs. You know, they're not like, okay, you just teach English, you just teach. They just have different really creative positions that they have, which I appreciate about private schools. They're able to innovate when it comes to like how they provide services to students and families. But one of the things I noticed about these schools is that they make you have to belong to a church before you can even be considered for the job. Do you think that anyone who works at a private school should have to belong to a church in order to work there?
My perspective on religion and churches is so, I don't want to say skewed. That makes me want some shrimp for some reason.
Ooh, that sounds good.
I know, right? No, I don't think so. I don't think they should have to be in your personal life for you to have a job.
You say yes? Mm-hmm. Why? You got the mic right there. You got to turn it on. Why you say that?
I got a mute button, so I got to unmute.
Why?
Okay. So let's say you're going through a Catholic school.
Okay.
And you're going to teach at a Catholic school. Mm-hmm. Don't you think you should understand what Catholicism is and how their belief structure work to teach those that go to that Catholic school? Because about 75% of your student body would be that of Catholic families. So it's kind of one of those things like, if you're going to work in this environment, you should know the environment. When you apply for a job, they always tell you research the company first, right?
Do you know how many public school teachers don't know shit about
English, math, arithmetic?
Where these kids arithmetic. Coming from? They don't know nothing
but
about.
But that's the difference between private parochial school and public school.
Okay.
Because
that's public why you got to pay, right?
Yeah, that's why you got to pay. And usually you're paying for the experience and you want to have your kids to be engulfed in a particular lifestyle while you're sitting to the school.
I agree now.
Not everybody goes to a private school because the public school in their area is trash. I went to what's considered one of the worst schools in the city of Milwaukee, and I had a fantastic education.
What school is that?
I went to North Division.
I was going
to
say North
Division. Oh, North is what's up.
But the thing about it is
back in the day.
But if you're looking at the paperwork, and you're looking at how schools are ranking, and you're looking at the stories that are told about the bad seeds from that area, you're going to look at North Division as an example of a, ooh, I won't send my kids there because this bad person went there and they're a product of their environment. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, North Division had a medical prep program in it, mm-hmm. meaning that we're creating doctors and dentists and nurses right. and all these things to basically have you a heads up. And I know several students who graduated from that program and became experts in their field.
I can agree now.
Yet you look at North Division as like, ooh, I'll never send my kids there because that school is in the 53206 zip code.
I mean, true.
You know, but that's a whole nother thing. We're talking about private school.
Whole nother time.
If you're sending a kid to a school, and that school is governed by a particular branch of religion, yes, it only makes sense to follow the school's curriculum to be a part of that school. I spent my first through eighth grade years at a Seventh-day Adventist school.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay,
that's a whole different thing.
That's a whole other different conversation.
That's like
comma but
Amish.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I can't even argue that. Yeah, mm-hmm. But every teacher who was not part of that school system never made it past the year. Not because they wasn't being normal, but
they weren't
indoctrinated.
Oh,
but more importantly, they didn't understand why certain religious aspects were more important to the school's curriculum. Mm-hmm. Like I was very advanced as a student, but I wasn't heavy into the religion side. I question everything.
Okay.
So I was considered a trouble student.
Mm-hmm. Are you still Seventh-day Adventist now?
Oh, hell no.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Hell no.
Okay. Yeah. No, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. I mean, so what I would say is, can you be religious without belonging to a church?
Yes.
Okay, so then is belonging to the church your proof? Like that, like a degree?
Belong to the church and not be an active member.
Exactly. I mean, that's what I'm saying.
You can
I mean,
join fraternities and sororities and not be active.
Right.
Shout out to, no, I'm joking.
We don't need to give me, we need to have a show about fraternities and sororities. That's
They ain't gonna tell you nothing.
I'm not gonna tell you.
They ain't gonna tell me nothing because I went to college.
They like the Black Illuminati. I will not.
They will not tell you anything.
That's what they think.
They will not tell you anything. They swear up and down, nothing happens.
The Black Illuminati.
You can't ask them anything.
Look at my face.
They're not gonna tell you. If you're not part of it, you're not gonna know nothing.
Then I'll tell you no secrets. Mm-hmm. And you ain't getting hired at that job.
Mm-mm. Okay, so anyway, that's the next show. No, I'm kidding.
Regular question is, what was your favorite high school lunch or your favorite school lunch?
I love that question.
Depends on where you went to school at.
Favorite school.
Because my sister went to Sherwood and they was able to go out for lunch.
Yeah, they have open campus. Still open campus. Yeah.
What did you eat when you were in the
club? Okay, let me tell you what I loved.
What?
She gonna say chicken patty.
Okay, so first of all, I went to Brown Deer. Brown Deer had this dope ass salad bar that I loved. It was so it was a salad bar.
Brown Deer is public adjacent.
It is public to a suburban.
It's suburban, but
it's
still
it's public adjacent, meaning it had all the perks and benefits of being a suburban school, but you were still publicly niggerish.
Okay, you are so right. But I loved salad bar when they had that because you had options. But you know what was the bomb? And we had like a lot of different things, but I loved chicken patty day.
See, told you, chicken patty. It's something about school's chicken patty.
And they used to you look for them as an adult. You're like, where the fuck did they get that?
It's not. And
I don't eat that now, but I love it.
Taste buds are different now, but it was something about chicken patties in school that just hit different.
I love them chicken patties. It's just because you were hungry as hell when by the time it was lunch.
Lips was white.
You smelled that corn cooking, them green
mine
beans.
Mine was a school pizza. I used to love
pizza. Everybody loved pizza. Mine. Yeah, I like that pizza.
So you know, okay.
And good.
And then sometimes it was burned. Sometimes it was undercooked.
Ours was good. Our school pizza was good.
Mine's was funny. It was actually the school's mock chicken leg.
Everybody loved mock chicken legs. I didn't like mock chicken legs.
I don't know what, because I can't find that, and I don't know what the mock chicken leg is.
Yeah, they sell them at Woodman.
Yeah, you can
but
get them.
What is a mock chicken
it's
leg?
Pork.
Pork in the form. Is it pork?
Yeah, it's pork.
I thought it was like ground meat, and then they form
it's
it.
Ground
they,
pork they in the form of a chicken leg.
I didn't know if it was pork. I thought it was
ground pork.
It is
breaded in panko in the form of a chicken leg.
So basically, it's a hot dog. That got reformed.
It's like fake vegan chicken, but it's meat.
Fake vegan chicken as meat.
But they did hit with the mashed potatoes and that gravy. That mock chicken leg used to
it'd be good, but I never knew what it was.
I never liked that. People used to run to the damn cafeteria on mock chicken leg day. I was not with that. I did not like that.
Pizza Friday and mock chicken leg day. I used to turn the mock chicken leg down some because it got a little bit. It's a taste that tastes like a penny.
Copper.
Yeah, it kind of got copperish over time.
That's not right.
I don't know. Yeah. Salad bar is probably my final
salad
answer.
Salad bar, they used to load it up with ranch and
because if you made your salad right, it was probably you get more food than you would.
Right.
Put it on that scale, that motherfucker be $20. You're like,
I had free lunch, so I didn't pay for mine.
Right. Wait, how did they do y'all free lunch in public school?
We had tickets.
We had that's impressive.
Okay, I apologize. I did not have free lunch. I had a reduced
who my baby lunch.
Yeah, you had to pay. I had to pay
35 cents. 30 cents.
I would not let them make me pay reduced lunch. I was like, don't try me later.
You had a card you could put like budget, you know, a balance on. Yeah, like, you only got $2.50.
No, we had the reduced lunch kids where I was. We had a ticket.
We had a ticket. You had
it's
a ticket.
So impressive.
It was colorful.
I
for each
somebody
bag.
Else thinking, are you eating your lunch today?
Right. That's what I ended up having to do. After a while, I find the one person who didn't eat the school lunch anyway. And I just take ticket. Just got that ticket.
I worked at a school that shall remain nameless that for their reduced lunch students, they had a different color plate.
That's segregation.
That's segregation at its fullest.
Because to me,
and everybody
lunch,
knew. Everybody knows.
Reduced lunch just means you were middle class.
It did.
If you look at it,
it did.
And free lunch means you were poor, right?
Free lunch country was poor. You were so reduced, poor.
Like, okay, we're reducing.
Like, you, your family got some money, but you barely making it. So you 35 cents, you good.
give me $4.
And if you had too much money, you couldn't get, you had to pay for your lunch
you
anyway.
You got to pay for it. You got a mom and dad in the house.
Or you brung a bag lunch.
I had to pay for mine. I used to be getting lunch tickets like a motherfucker, though. Like, dog, give me a lunch ticket. you brought your lunch.
Yeah, but some schools, if you depending on what school you are at, lunch could cost you $10 a day.
Yeah, lunch is expensive.
You know, like, because sometimes they have options. Like, some of those private schools, you know, like, they got like little subs. Did you pack your kids
bag lunches? Other than field trip days?
Let me ask you a question. Do schools like, let's just use Sherwood, because I know they were open lunch. Do schools that are open lunch like that still have free lunch programs?
Yeah.
Because
there's some people that can't go out and buy them McDonald's.
Yeah, but
that definitely has to be a real shock to your ego.
Well, for a couple of years, which I think they should just do no matter what, because of the pandemic, everybody got free lunch. No matter who you were, no matter how much your parents made,
that way, period.
It was free lunch, no matter what. And that was one of the things that I knew I was in a different environment when I saw school lunch in some schools, because let me tell y'all something. Some of these kids, they be having bento boxes and they be having like individual jars full of fresh organic greens and like their mom got up and like cut little forms of, you know, a sandwich.
Cut the ends off the bread.
They got like organic cheeses and, you know, sushi for lunch and like for real. I mean, like, yeah, let's not go too deep into lunch.
I remember I went to one of the Brookfield schools. Like, I played football, so, you know, you go play that game at their school, and you stay at that school for the whole day, and then you play the game that afternoon. And we had their lunch, and they had an actual, like, two restaurants in the school.
Yeah. Wow. I worked at schools like that.
They had the, and I want to say, it wasn't Chick-fil-A. That didn't happen until later on in life.
Probably
McDonald's. But they had, it was like a Pizza Hut or something. They had actual restaurants in the school.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And the students were actually the ones working there. So
one school I worked at had Rockies.
Wow.
Yeah. You could just get slices. Well, it wasn't Milwaukee. It was Milwaukee adjacent. Milwaukee County.
It's in Wisconsin, because I don't think Rocky is everywhere. I think that's a Midwest.
So they must have like had a partnership with Rockies where they offered their pizza at the school.
Every day.
And then you can go over here to this other part, and then they had Subway sandwiches.
That's what it was. It was Pizza Hut and Subway. Yeah,
you could just grab the sandwiches like a college campus.
Yeah.
But just imagine what it must be like to have to pay for that every day.
But see, I don't think that they had to pay for that. I'm not saying they didn't have to pay for it. I think
you don't have to pay at North Division, them kids grabbing 4, 5, 6.
No, I'm not talking about at North. I'm talking at this Brookfield school. I think that was just the norm of their school selection.
Well, and don't even get me started about how many kids get Uber Eats during lunch, or mom and dad is dropping off Chick-fil-A or McDonald's or whatever nowadays. Like Uber Eats, Grubhub, all that, stuff. They DoorDash and food. It's, you know.
And it's so normal now, because even my youngest.
They want to know how to cook when they get older.
Like my kids, they have green light cards. So they have their own little debit cards with their allowance and stuff, right? And they literally have DoorDash using their card before. So I'm like, I want to take these things from you because you're 10. Why are you doing this? But it's the norm. It's the norm now.
That's scary.
So let me tell you my medium question. I should have switched the order of this, but it's going to be my medium. Okay. So do you remember when the school choice program started in Milwaukee?
The 220 kind of program?
Yeah. No, the school choice.
Yeah. What's the difference?
So school choice is it was conceived in 1989. It was families who felt like they were failed by, you know, public school education. So they lobbied to have the allocation of resources that would be designated per student to be sent to private schools, including religious schools. So you're able to take whatever allocation your student would get for a public school, you could take that money out and send it to a private school. So your kid could go to a private school without you having to pay for it. Okay, so that was school choice. So Howard Fuller was a big advocate of it. Polly Williams, who was a school board member. It was like it started in Milwaukee, I think, and then it like spread throughout the country. Yeah, right.
To the world. The U.S.
Right. So do you think that school choice is still relevant and necessary?
No.
No, I think because they had a point to prove, and I think now that it's proven its point, I think people need to just allow access to, if you apply for this school and you can afford it, let's go here. If we got programs, let's work it out. Yeah.
Okay. Tom, you think so?
I say no, because the one thing about that program, it actually hurted the public school system more than anything.
Yeah, because it took funding away.
It took funding away. It was bad enough that, like, Milwaukee has a lot of schools. We still, even though we closed a lot of them, we still got a lot of them now.
Poor Jackie Robinson, though.
Jackie Robinson closed?
Jackie Robinson is a senior living facility.
Wow.
There are other schools that have closed in Milwaukee for sure.
I know.
Like Juno.
Thomas Edison.
Yeah. I think Juno reopened, though.
Yeah, I remember Juno closed. I was sad when Juno closed.
Yeah, I was.
But the thing about it is if you think about it, a lot of those schools that we did lose during all this transition, that amount of money that was taken because kids were allowed to go to other places. And plus with Milwaukee, we have a lot of parochial schools or private schools like Hope. No knock on Hope, fantastic schools. But look at how many kids came out of public school and went to Hope to the point that Hope was able to grow to at least three campuses now. And they were really just a small little hole in the wall on Capitol at first. So imagine how much public funding got taken away if you look at every single kid that went to Hope.
That was the initiative. They wanted to say, you black kids don't deserve any education. Let's take it away from you.
No. I get that. But choice was a little bit different. It was like, you can go wherever you feel is a good school. And here's money to do that. So now you're building up already successful private schools who are getting money elsewhere. And yes, you're giving these kids a better experience, but you're not giving them the experience they need. Because taking an African-American kid from the 53206 and dropping them in, let's say, a Brookfield school district, not only is your struggle going to be different because certain private schools, they don't teach you what to learn. They teach you how to learn. Whereas an MPS teach you what to learn, pass these tests, and keep it moving. So if you've done 8 years of just this by the book learning, and now you're dropped into this critical thinking environment, you're not going to know what to do. And then on top of that, there's a culture shock on top of it.
Yeah.
Because you got to remember, you're being bussed out here. Meanwhile, your classmate just pulled up
in the latest
Mercedes Benz, and they don't care what happened to this car because they're going to get another one next week. And now you can't socialize with them because you got to be back at a certain time. You can't. The bus only goes to 124th and Capitol. So to get over to the Brookfield side, you got to have a friend to come get you, or you got to drive over there.
Because I remember it.
It's a shock. So you're treated like a natural outcast all because your mom and dad tried to give you a better education. And not looking at it from the experience point of view that you're actually setting your child up to fail because they're not being accepted.
That's a good point.
They could not be accepted.
Yeah. What's your media?
I didn't mean to go that deep.
No, that's good. I like that.
I got serious there.
Well, I have two more questions because my other questions kind of ran over. If you could do any year in high school over, which year would it be?
Sophomore.
Any year in high school over?
Mine would be junior.
Sophomore was the year I actually became who I was.
That's a good question.
Kicking my freshman year was my transition year from private school to public. So breaking that 7A Avenue mentality and acclimating to my blackness. Sophomore year is when I was joining clubs. I was in organization. I was really finding myself. I started Upper Bound.
Why is it a year over?
Because that was the year that I really found myself.
Well, why do it over, though?
Why do it over? Because there were some experiences that I didn't appreciate the time that I had it.
But it taught you a lesson.
It did. But if I knew, if hindsight was 20/20, And I knew things like GE scholars or starting upper bound or pre-college programs or being on the football team or being on the basketball and track.
That wouldn't have made you the person you are now, Tom.
What I'm saying is if I could do it over with the knowledge I have now, I would appreciate that those moments.
Baby,
would I change anything? Probably not.
LGBTQ group, coming out group. Right. I would have started so much.
I think my answer would be senior year. And that seems like the obvious answer, but well, because my senior year, I was pretty much done. So I was taking a bunch of art classes just to fill time. Because they wouldn't let me just go half day. So
they wouldn't
let
me go half day either.
Fine, I'll just take a bunch of art classes. But I wish I was like, and then me and one of my best friends, we would just go and leave campus because we had like 2 study halls because we were pretty much done with our requirements. So we would take this van that this other classmate would loan us. We would just get his keys and go to every mall in the city and just like, oops. Walk around. No, just like shop.
Hey, you got it.
We were going shopping. We were like visiting every mall and just like that was our goal before the end of the year was just to go to every mall and just shop.
Y'all went to the Grand.
And we went to the Grand. We went Capital to Southridge. I don't know if Capitol Court was still there at the time. We went to Bayshore. We went to Northridge. We went to every
Capitol Court worth going to?
Probably not.
That's the question.
Y'all gonna leave Capitol Court alone. Capitol Court was that mall. Okay?
I saw that picture you sent.
It is very intricate in our history.
Capitol Court was that mall.
Why aren't there more images of Capitol Court? I want to see the inside.
Because after Target left, Capitol Court wasn't the same.
I remember Oak Tree in Capitol Court.
Yes.
Oh, the food court in Capitol Court. The Barrio's Pizza.
Barrio's has been around for a long time.
That was a great food court. And
like Sabario has only been
Chinese food in Capitol Court. Used to hit. Okay. Wow.
Why do you have a good memory?
Only for certain stuff because I used to work at Capitol Court.
That's why he was always there.
My sister worked at Target in Capitol Court.
Best friend used to work at Target.
Senior year because I would probably make my experience more rich. Maybe I would try to take more classes, really prepare myself for college because I feel like I wasn't really prepared for my freshman year in college.
But it's your senior year. You were supposed
to too many study halls.
What's your last question?
My last question is, so which do you think was more scandalous and probably more frequent? Was it public school teachers, men or women, having affairs with students, or private school priests molesting kids?
Oh,
public school teachers having affairs
with students. Yeah, I will say that because I don't know because
I know 2 scenarios where
I know a lot of girls who could tell me now that they was messing around with a teacher that was in high school.
I know one that really blew up a lot of spots.
I can't personally say I know anybody who was messing around with Brother Bob.
I have to say the public school teacher because, and this is a bad thing to say, a priest and a student or a priest and a young person became a norm for a while.
Ooh,
like we was hearing about it all
like the
time.
The Dalai Lama sucking that little boy's tongue.
His tongue out at him. I seen the video. He stuck his tongue out.
It was very weird.
It was weird, but
you have to understand the Dalai Lama and all that kind of stuff. They took a sound bite and just turned it into this whole thing.
Yeah,
and
that's all they really did.
They really
I saw the whole video. I still think it was very suspect.
Let the Dalai Lama alone.
I don't do
half of us didn't even think he was still alive, let alone.
I don't like anything that has to do with kids.
I feel you.
All that stuff just is really.
Maybe the Dalai Lama is very childlike himself.
He probably is. He's probably very innocent.
I was going to tell a story.
The Dalai Lama don't know nothing about social media. Do you think he cares about cancel culture?
He's probably completely out of touch with that.
Right.
Yeah.
And in that moment right there probably showed it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying it was right.
You don't like this answer, do you?
I don't like anything that has to do with kids. Kids should be fed, bathed, and clothed, and taught.
That is so archaic.
I'm sorry. I think of kids as archaic animals and creatures.
Yeah, they shouldn't have.
You would be one of the kids are to be seen, not heard kind of people.
So y'all, final answer is the public school teachers.
Okay. Only because teachers. I really know some situations.
I think it was sensationalized in the media for sure. I never knew a case where anyone I knew personally had any.
Ask your friends now if they had anything, if they were playing with a teacher in high school. And I bet you'd get some like, yeah, I was.
Ooh, it's a lot more now that are coming out.
Yikes.
Like, there are so many female teachers that are getting exposed to.
Oh, just female, huh? Hold on. Male teachers ain't doing none of that.
I know they're doing stuff because those
but
are coaches
that get exposed, right?
So they get fired on the side, but it'd be a whole nother, because you got to look at the stigma of younger women with older men are always harsher than younger men with older women.
Okay. All right. I believe that.
And now it's starting to become an equal playing field with teachers, whether male or female, of the harshness that's happening to it.
Mm. Okay. So you got a final answer. Do you have a final question?
You sound like that. You did not agree
with
that answer.
I think that, I don't know. It's something about how sensationalized women teachers who have affairs with students have become. Just
it's
interesting.
Like,
and
like
I think,
a badge of honor now.
And I think, no, I don't think it's a badge of honor. I think it's shameful. And then I feel like there must be just as many men who do it. And I don't think it's put on blast the way it does when women do it.
There's a hell of a lot more women that are doing it. And men, a lot of women get away with it because dudes think that's a badge of honor.
Right. And that's
what
I was saying.
They don't know that they're being molested. They're just thinking they having sex with an older woman.
So do you think that men teachers who do, they just don't do it? Or they just
men teachers are getting smarter to not put themselves in those positions.
Mm-hmm. I wish that was the case, but
because it's not
a
just
lot
heterosexual
girls
stuff.
Are getting a lot more smarter and knowing that to not mess with those men, that men are trying to take advantage of them because they see in the Lifetime movies and all that.
True.
Men are just filthy, disgusting creatures.
Are you not a man?
I'm speaking for myself too. Yeah, but women are filthy, disgusting creatures too.
Yikes.
They just don't talk about it.
You might be right about that.
No, they talk amongst each other. They just don't do it.
They
publicly.
Talk about it. Mm. A woman will do a lot of stuff. Did y'all hear about that 16-year-old girl having sex with a dog?
Ew. I don't even want to know.
I seen it popped up, but I did not see it. Mm-mm.
Don't want to know.
I didn't see it, but I heard it.
Don't want to know.
It was
on my timeline last weekend. No, thank you. Ew. Okay, last question.
I know, right?
Ew.
Like, girl, what would make you want to do that?
No, thank you.
My last question is, I got to get back to him. Did you guys have Snapple in high school?
Yes.
I was addicted to Snapple. That's my last question.
It was disgusting.
It was so good.
Did you remember the rumor that it was founded by the KKK?
Yeah, I remember that.
The strawberry kiwi frozen used to be my
That strawberry kiwi was the one.
That strawberry kiwi was so nasty.
It was so hidden. And then now they sell the little drink packets. I always freeze my water and put that
in. Little iced tea lemon.
Hater. Snapple to a Slim Jim.
Snapple was gross. It was disgusting. Ew. Snapple is terrible. You know what was a better alternative?
Water.
Clearly Canadian.
I love Clearly Canadian.
That's how I know you went to a suburban adjacent public school.
When I went on field trip, that's what I used to get.
Canadian Clear.
I tried to drink Snapple and I would take two sips and I would be like, ew.
It's too much sugar.
It was like it was too sweet. That's probably what it was.
It was disgusting. Ew. No. Clearly
we're
Canadian.
Like every show, we like to end.
You see Tyler's face when he said,
"What are we deleting here today?" Other than Snapple not being,
I was just about
Shana.
To say Snapple. Delete that bullshit.
You cannot delete Snapple.
Snapple still exists, by the way. Don't you know that?
I know. I said what I said.
That's what you said.
Okay, so I'll make a real one. Okay, so I think I want to delete this. Divide between I want to delete the idea that students in public schools don't have any empathy or moralistic ideologies, that they are just guided by nothing, because I think there are some people who really are working to incorporate mindfulness and social emotional practices and restorative practices and a sense of community and art and creativity in public schools that aren't really related to religious dogma, but they still act as a moral guide for students.
I agree.
Even if it's not like, you're going to go to hell if you don't do this. It's like, we are all connected. And if you do this, you are connected to all of these human beings and you need to understand that. So they are trying to counter the messages that we get about, you know, me, get yours.
Right.
There are educators who are actively working without necessarily having a religious angle on it.
Oh, okay.
But there's still a humanistic angle.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't say that religion isn't important. But they're doing it in their own way. They're still trying to hold people accountable in their own way.
I like that, Shauna.
Thank you.
I just want to delete the notion that parents thinking that teenagers have to be so responsible for everything and they have so much other stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
And we were a teenager before and we really need to, even though kids get on my motherfucking nerves, we really need to really stop and talk to our kids and really get to know them and understand them, mm-hmm, and appreciate them and respect them, because that's what's happening. Kids aren't being respected. Kids aren't being appreciated. Kids aren't being spoken to. Their parents could care less what they're doing as long as they're not bothering them. I just think we need to go back to really having conversations with our kids, not grown-up conversations, but we also need to stop letting kids know everything.
Ooh, too much. They be in too many conversations.
They should know if you having
trouble. They be too grown these days.
You need to work that shit out and go on about your business. I ain't never know when mama was struggling.
Never.
Did you know when your mama was struggling? She didn't put that shit on you. She didn't put that pressure on you.
I had a sense.
You had a sense because you were grown.
But she didn't talk to me like I was grown.
And she didn't make it feel like it was your fault. She didn't call you out your name. You didn't hear the conversation.
Right.
You weren't smoking weed with your mama. You weren't drinking with your mama. You weren't having to bring
trying
your
help,
mama
trying
no
to help
money.
Her, feeling like you had to solve the problem. No.
Yeah, mm-mm, we didn't have to go through that. Mm-mm. So I really want that to be taken away. That's my prayer, is that tension and that anguish is taken away from our youth, that they have to be so responsible.
Mm-hmm. That makes so much sense.
That they just can just be youth. You can be 18 and just live the rest of your life, mm-hmm, dog. You have so much more to do.
Love that.
So that's it, guys. Welcome to another episode of Download and Delete.
Yeah.
I am Ty Monsier. Bye.
Bye. Shauna Lucas. Bye.